What is striking is that only a minority of students actually report interest in a scientific career for themselves. So the closer you get from general appreciation of science to actually taking this on as your own career, the less positive is the proportion. That is a picture we see in the United States, but across countries, across OECD countries as well. The next slide, and again, you see a relationship with performance. The next slide I will skip. I wanted to just say a few words about science and the environment. When we conceptualized the science assessment, we also thought it was very important to see to what extent do young people at age 15 see science not just something as a school subject, but, for example, to what extent do they understand issues like climate change and all of those kinds of global environmental issues. And you can see, actually, that in the US, a lot of students have quite good awareness of those kind of issues. However, it is related very closely to science performance. Those kids who didn't do well on science also didn't understand or didn't show much awareness of those kinds of environmental issues. We also saw that in the US, it's very closely linked to their social background. Kids from disadvantaged, or 15-year-olds from disadvantaged backgrounds, didn't show the same appreciation. They also, students express concerns for environmental issues, but they report less so than an OECD average level, a sense of personal responsibility for sustainable development. What we find is, and that's true in many other countries as well, that students are generally quite pessimistic that those challenges can be addressed successfully. We ask them, to what extent do you believe that in the next 20 years those big global challenges are going to be solved? And a minority of students were positive about this, and the less they knew, the more optimistic they were. So the more ignorant the students actually were in science, the easier they thought, well, these things are all going to be sorted out by themselves. It shows you somehow what happens if baseline scientific competence are not deeply rooted in populations. This is about the low trail of performance I showed you before. I wanted to move on to another important aspect. This is about equity in learning outcomes. You have seen that slide. That's basically the distribution of countries on the scale. But this is just average performance. Another thing that we paid great attention to is the gap between winners and losers in the education systems. To what extent does socioeconomic background influence the success of young people? We measure that as well. Because that measure, the degree to which social background determines your learning outcomes, is an indicator of the efficiency of education systems to utilize their potential. If the success of people depends very strongly on their social background, education systems are not utilizing their potential. And you see that in some countries. But you also see that in other countries, learning opportunities are much more equitably distributed in the sense that social background matters much less. If you look at this chart, everybody wants to be there, where performance is very strong and socioeconomic equity is very pronounced. Nobody wants to be there where performance is poor and there are large socioeconomic disparities. That's obvious. The last two quadrants you can probably debate more. Is it better to do well on average at the price of large disparity? Or is it better to focus on equity and accept mediocrity? The interesting thing is that we can sort of turn that kind of philosophical debate into data, and we can actually see how countries play out. And what you do see is, and that's what I want to really stress here, that there are a number of countries in every world region that succeed in generating high levels of performance and an equitable distribution of learning opportunities. You take your neighboring country, Canada in North America, you could take Finland in Europe, or many other countries you take in East Asia as well. One can look in this in more detail. Well, actually, I'm going to skip that now. One of the lessons that we see when we actually plot socioeconomic background against school performance, and I'm choosing my own country, Germany here, is that much of that relationship is not just coming directly from families, but has to do with the extent to which education systems moderate and reinforce socioeconomic disparities. Here you have the case of Germany. The direct impact of families is modeled in yellow. You can see, yes, where children come from better educated, wealthier families, they tend to do a little bit better, but the real impact is the blue line, which shows you the impact of the education system at the school level. So you can see actually an example of a country that reinforces socioeconomic background through the education system. If you look at the United States, the pattern is pretty similar, a bit less pronounced. And now you can ask yourself, well, is that an inevitable feature? Does it always have to be like this? And then you look at a country like Finland or Canada in your case, where you can see the yellow line is very similar. The direct impact that family background has on learning outcomes is virtually the same in every country of the OECD. You can't change those things equally. You can't make poorer families richer. You can't make less educated families more educated. But what is interesting is that this blue line, the system level relationship, is absolutely flat in the case of Finland. Here you have a system that actually is able to moderate the impact of social background. So that again shows us that this is something that is achievable, and there are other countries in that group as well. Finally, on that score, immigrants and science performance, what do we see? First of all, 15-year-olds with an immigrant background, that is a major challenge in the United States. You have about 15% in the United States, but there are a number of countries that actually have significantly higher proportion of immigrants. And there are a number of countries that have a significantly more disadvantaged proportion of immigrants. And while immigrant students are a challenge anywhere, you can see that some of the countries actually do well. And most of the countries that have larger shares of immigrant populations do better than the United States. So this is a challenge, but you can also see that it's very successfully addressed in many countries. We see that in the United States, but also in some other countries, second-generation immigrant students who have already been born in the country are not doing better than first-generation students who just came into the country, which also we take as an indicator, as one possible explanation, that actually those issues are not going away by themselves. But what is very interesting, we do find some countries that are very, very successful in at least moving the second generation of immigrants up. We also see that in the United States, as well as in other countries, immigrant students often face the double disadvantage of being coming from a lower socioeconomic background and being put into schools that have also a lower average socioeconomic intake. And finally, I wanted to say that immigrant students in general, particularly first-generation students, tend to report positive attitudes towards science. A very interesting finding. It's not that they are disengaged from learning, but in fact they have a high level of motivation and general value of things, but somehow education systems don't seem to be that good in using that potential. I wanted, well, that's just the data for that. I've said everything. I wanted to show you one picture more, which I think is very, very important, and that is the question, to what extent do education systems succeed in establishing coherence in educational standards throughout the education system? This chart here shows you the performance variation across countries. It's the, basically the variance, the gap between the better and poorer performing students. The longer the bar, the greater the variance in student performance. And you can see the United States is among the countries with the longest gap. You can ask yourself when you look at this, where does this performance variation come from? Is it something that comes from students and their families? Or is it because schools vary in the average quality of outcomes? And actually, you can do that statistically by dividing that bar up into two components. The upper end shows you the variation of student performance inside schools, and the dark yellow part shows you the performance variation between schools. And the most impressive result for me is actually, again, if you take a country like Finland, you remember number one performer overall. Moderate variation student performance. And only 4% of the performance variation is between schools. So if you are a parent, you don't worry very much where you put your child. You can rely on predictable outcomes of educational performance throughout the education system, in the entire country, across all socioeconomic groups. This is really where success in education has become systemic. You can see other countries where there's a huge variation of performance across schools, where most of the variation that we observe is a factor of quality difference across schools.